by the power of his blood. Amen. Amen. I'm alive because he lived. Amen. I was dead in the grave. I was covered in sin and shame. I heard mercy call my name. Let my song join the world that never ends.
amazing grace find you. join us now as we sing our hymn, Up From the Grave He Arose.
Jesus, my Savior, waiting the coming day. Jesus, my Lord, up from the grave he rose with a mighty triumph of his foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with the saints to reign. He arose. My Savior, vainly they steal the dead. Jesus, my Lord, up from the grave he rose with a mighty triumph of all his foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. He arose.
Good morning and welcome to worship at Perdido Bay United Methodist Church. My name is David and I'm one of the pastors here. I want to welcome everyone who is worshiping with us virtually today. If you are visiting with us, you can just say in the comments that you're one of our visitors today. We're glad to have everyone gathered together, even in this unique way for worship. We are beginning a sermon series on the book of Acts. And I'm excited for Levi's sermon just a moment. And I also wanted to encourage you, if you haven't found our Reading Acts for Easter reading assignments, we hope that you'll go online and look that up. Each day, Pastor Levi or myself will be giving devotions as we continue our podcast series daily, talking about the different readings of Scripture. Our congregation read the Gospel of Luke together during Lent as we prepared for Easter, and now in this Easter season, we're going to be reading Acts together. We hope that you'll join us in that. I want to thank everyone at home watching, and we look forward to a time when we can all be together in person soon. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful for this season of Easter, where each Sunday we remember the resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ. We claim again that victory we have in Jesus. We know that because he lives, he has given us a peace that will live forever, a joy that will live forever, a hope and a promise that surpasses all this world's understanding, but that death and sin and sorrow and sadness and darkness will be swallowed up in the victory of Jesus Christ. We thank you for the opportunity to worship. We ask a special blessing and prayer upon all those who continue to suffer, especially during this uncertain time, for those who've lost jobs and income, for those who've lost loved ones, for those who are suffering illness. We ask a special blessing of peace, that your power and your healing touch be upon them. Hold this world in the palm of your hands, O God. And teach us again that your Son is risen and is the great physician of us all. In his holy name we pray as he taught, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We hope you enjoy this children's moment.
Good morning, everybody. Today I wanted to do a quick little lesson to show you that we can trust God no matter what. Abby and Sam, do you guys think that God holds you in his hands?
Yes.
Yeah, he absolutely does. But what happens when bad things happen? Like when one of your best friends moves away, or when we're stuck in quarantine for so long and we feel all alone, does he still hold us in his hands?
Yes!
Yes! And how do we know that we can trust him?
God.
We can trust God because
he loves us.
He loves us, absolutely. And you know that I love you, right?
Right.
Right. And this bag of water is very full, isn't it?
Yeah.
And I'm going to hold it over your head. But I don't think that I'm going to let you get wet. Do you believe me?
Yeah.
Yes. I am holding this bag. And if I dropped it on you, it would bust all over the place and you'd be soaking wet and very unhappy, right?
Right.
Well, do you still trust me? Come here, Shepherd. Do you still trust me if I said I was going to poke a hole in the bag?
Yeah.
Yes? Well, that's exactly what I'm going to do. I'm going to hold this over your head and I'm going to poke holes in the bag. Wow, look at that. Oh my goodness! I'm super impressed because you still trusted me, even though I'm poking holes in this bag, and there's no reason for it not to be getting you wet. But you know that because I love you, I am able to be trusted, right? And because you trust me, you'll let me hold this over your head and not spill any water on you, right? I might spill this water on them later on purpose, just for fun. But we'll see how the day goes. So let's all remember to trust God. Come here, Shepherd. Trust God with everything that we have because he loves us and we can trust him. Thanks.
I am the church.
You are the church.
We are the church together.
All who follows Jesus.
All around the world.
Yes, we're the church together.
Good morning, Perdido Bay United Methodist Church family and all of those who are joining us for worship this morning. Or perhaps you're watching it in the afternoon or in the evening. Whenever you are watching, wherever you are watching, we welcome you and are so very grateful to have you alongside of us in this time of declaring the greatness of the risen Christ. And on Wednesday, the 22nd of April, we're going to be having a midday prayer opportunity. I'm going to be gathering and we're going to be going live and we're going to have an opportunity to pray together. I'm going to lead us through a time of structured prayer, and you will have a chance to share a prayer request in the comments below, and we will have an opportunity to lift those up together. The following Wednesday, April the 29th at noon, Pastor David is going to lead us through a Wesleyan love feast. This is very similar to communion, but it is a little bit different. It's something that early Methodists practiced when there was not a pastor present to come together to have a feast, to gather around a table and to declare the goodness of God and the promise and the presence of God among them. So we hope that you'll join us on April the 22nd at noon and April the 29th at noon as we have our midday service of prayer and as we practice the Wesleyan Love Feast on April the 29th. But today, we are beginning a new sermon series on the book of Acts. In fact, it's technically a continuation of our sermon series on the Gospel of Luke. When the Bible was put together and canonized as we have it today, there was a decision made to break the book of Luke, Acts, into two separate entities. They did this because the book of Acts focuses on the work of the Holy Spirit, the ministry of the Apostle Paul, and the growth of the early church, whereas the Gospel of Luke focuses on the ministry, the life, and the witness of Jesus Christ in the world. However, it is clear that when Luke wrote Luke Acts, he wrote it to be read continuously. This is why he begins the book of Acts with these words. In the first book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus did and taught from the beginning until the day when he was taken up to heaven after giving instructions to the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen. So Luke is letting us know this is not a separate story, but a continuation of the story, a continuation of the book. Initially, Pastor David and I intended on beginning a new sermon series today on a totally different topic. But God, as God always does when we are listening, led us to a different direction, a different topic. So much of the action in the book of Acts takes place in homes, not cathedrals, not church buildings, not religious buildings as we know them today, but in the homes of faithful followers of the risen Jesus Christ. Perhaps since the inception of the church, of those first meetings of the infant Christian church, since that day, I don't believe there have been as many Christians worshiping in their homes since then as there is today. Around the globe, socially distant Christians are worshiping in their homes, worshiping with their families, lifting the name of Christ. If the majority of Christians in the book of Acts were worshiping in homes, and if the majority of Christians are worshiping in homes today, how in the world could we ignore this book of Holy Scripture that witnesses to the power of God coming alive in homes, but also to recognize the fact of how the power of God is coming alive in your home in this very moment? Our first sermon is called The House of Faith, and our passage comes to us from Acts chapter 1, verses 12 through 17 and 21 through 26. Let us listen for the word of the Lord. Then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey away. When they had entered the city, they went to the room upstairs where they were staying. Peter and John and James and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James, son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas, son of James. All these were constantly devoting themselves to prayer together with certain women, including Mary, the mother of Jesus, as well as his brothers. In those days, Peter stood up among the believers. Together, the crowd numbered about 120 persons, and said, "Friends, the scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit through David foretold concerning Judas, who became a guide for those who arrested Jesus. For he was numbered among us and was allotted his share in this ministry. So one of the men who have accompanied us during all the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John until the day when he was taken up from us, one of these must become a witness with us to his resurrection." So they proposed two: Joseph, called Barsabbas, who was also known as Eustace, and Matthias. Then they prayed, and they said, "Lord, you know everyone's heart. Show us which one of these you have chosen to take the place in this ministry and apostleship from which Judas turned aside to go to his own place." And they cast lots for them, and the lot fell on Matthias, and he was added to the 11 apostles. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Heavenly Father, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be pure and acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. On Palm Sunday, Caroline Merritt and I were worshiping alongside of our church family via live stream in our living room. And as we were doing this, I started weeping because there was something so poignant, so special, so tender that was unfolding in our home. I was holding our precious daughter in my arms with her little hand lifted high in praise. I heard Caroline lifting her voice, singing the worship songs, and I could feel the overflowing blessings of God in that moment. The blessing of a loving family, the blessing of a home, the blessing of his power, the blessing of His presence among us that knows no bounds. But at the same time, not only was I weeping over the tenderness and the joyousness of that moment, but I was weeping because I realized I missed being with all of you. I missed seeing our amazing children marching in on Palm Sunday, waving their palm branches, singing their hosannas to Almighty God. I was missing the gathered assembly of God's people on the Sabbath day. But God quickly and powerfully reminded me that we were still gathered. Yes, we may not have been in this gym or over in the sanctuary, but we were together in that moment. Although not physically present, God's Holy Spirit was and is and will continue to bind us together, whether we are physically present or not. On that Palm Sunday morning, I had the realization that maybe for the first time, your home is becoming a sanctuary. That my home is becoming a sanctuary. Because we are hearing our spouses, our children, our roommates worshiping God. So often in a sanctuary, we can think that our voices don't matter. But what worship in our home calls us to recognize is that your voice matters. Your child's voice matters. Your spouse's voice matters. Even more so, your engagement and your example in worship matters. Parents in this time are being given an unprecedented opportunity to model for their families what worship looks like for their children, regardless of their children's ages. For the first time, maybe spouses are hearing each other sing. Families are together, unified in praise. May we not miss the gift of this blessing that is present, even as we are wading through the uncertainty of this time. When we really think about it, the walls of homes were the first witnesses to Christ's ministry. And the walls of homes of followers of Jesus Christ will continue to be the place wherein we are called to welcome God's presence and reign, even when things return to a new normal. In Acts chapter 1, we see the disciples holding church in a home, and how as they are in that home worshiping God, that God does a great thing among them. It wasn't in the temple, it wasn't in some grand sanctuary, but it was in a humble upper room where God moved again. Here is what the church looked like in the beginning. When they had entered the city, they went to the room upstairs where they were staying. Peter and John and James and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James son of Alphaeus and Simon the Zealot, and Judas son of James. All these were constantly devoting themselves to prayer, together with certain women, including the Mary, a mother of Jesus, as well as his brothers. It was this simple. People coming together, praying, sharing a meal, and singing songs that they surely would have known from their Jewish traditions. Amazingly, this format of worship has remained largely intact for over 2,000 years. If gathering together to worship was critical for the disciples who walked day by day alongside Jesus Christ and witnessed his resurrection and his ascension, how much more imperative is worship for us today who are followers of the risen Christ? Although some of us are at home alone and isolated from others right now, you are not alone in your worship, because you are unified with others in your family of faith. We were never made to be in indefinite physical isolation from other believers, whether in our homes or in sanctuaries. But we know by reading in Scripture that worship is and worship will always be the act of God's community coming together to be made alive in the power of the Holy Spirit, to pray together, to sing hymns, and to share the sacraments. As I was reading this episode in Acts 1, and I'm sure as you were reading it as well, that my mind was nudged to an event that took place in a very similar space not too long before this moment that we have in the book of Acts. This moment ought to be very familiar to us as it is reminiscent of Jesus' meal in the upper room with his Last Supper with his disciples. But not only was it Jesus' Last Supper, I believe that in that moment, Jesus was creating a venue for us to understand worship and to give us a pattern to follow, to worship the living and eternal God. Consider the intimacy of your home. Consider the intimacy of this upper room or the upper room that Christ was in with his disciples. When you are in your home or in the home of another, first and foremost, you are welcomed into a place of comfort, a place of ownership, a place of safety, of security, of familiarity. Shame on us if the church ever feels like it cannot or does not provide that same feeling, that same environment of intimacy for the people of God to come, to know one another, to grow in fellowship with each other, and to worship together. Just like Caroline Merritt and I felt in our home on Palm Sunday, I know that many of you have had this same profound experience, this same moment of realization, these same moments of tears coming down your face as you sense the power of God alive in your home. Because there is a depth of intimacy, church, that happens naturally when you are comfortable and when you are open to lifting your voice without shame. When you are praying out loud because you aren't worried about someone else hearing you. When you are teaching your children how to sing a hymn or a song of praise. Or when you're holding hands with your children or with your significant other as you worship God together. When you are comfortable, when you feel as if you are in an intimate environment, inevitably we will be more surrendered to receiving and hearing the presence of God. It is when we are surrendered that we are most apt to hear the voice of God, the Spirit of God leading you, calling you, strengthening you, teaching you. Of course, it is impossible to recreate the absolute comfort and the same environment of our homes in our sanctuary. But I believe that as we yearn for God's people to have that same intimacy and comfort in our sanctuaries, that God will work in and through us to create that environment of comfort, of surrender, of spiritual intimacy with God, and of the intimacy of friendship with one another that we experience in our homes. It is when we create the intersection of the comfort of home with the comfort of God's sanctuary, where I believe that God's power is unleashed in unimaginable and transcendent ways. Acts 1, the early church, as they gathered in homes, what they are teaching us is that intimacy with God and intimacy with one another is the purpose of Christian fellowship and Christian worship. We were never created to be anonymous pawns filing in and out of a worship space only to show back up the next Sunday to continually fly under the radar and be unnoticed by others in the church. A commitment to including each person, to have a passionate pursuit of God's presence, and to have relentless engagement with discovering our role and God's work in the world. That is what worship facilitates now, and that is what worship led the people of Acts 1 to experience, and what I believe in this moment you are having in your living room and in living rooms around the world, and will continue to happen in our sanctuary when we are able to come back together. As they were in that home that day in Acts 1, the 11 remaining apostles and those gathered recognized that there was a void in their midst. They sensed an emptiness because of the death of Judas Iscariot. They knew that they were incomplete without having a 12th apostle. And so they began to do just as we do today when we consider leaders in the church. They prayed. In this fledgling group of Jesus followers, there were 12 original apostles, and then we read of about 120 others who were known to be followers of Jesus in the city of Jerusalem. The leadership of the early church was the apostles, and then there were the 120 others who had been taken by this ministry of Jesus, who had responded to his call of discipleship and had given their life to being witnesses to the resurrection. Everyone, each and every person, had a place in that small movement, and they had a purpose for furthering the church of Christ in that day, and it remains the same for Christ's church today. There will always be those set aside for clergy leadership and for lay leadership, but even still, those 120 others gathered in that place in Jerusalem and in the church today have a role to play in carrying out the gospel ministry in this church and whatever church you may be a part of and in your community. This house church moment, I believe, is the moment where we see the house of faith coalescing for the first time, because we see everything in that house church that we see in the church as we know it today. We see leadership coming together as Matthias is chosen to take the place of Judas. He is chosen because, just like Joseph called Barsabbas, he had a presence in the church, a commitment to the church, and showed gifts for leadership. They sought God's wisdom on who would replace Judas Iscariot in the council of leaders. But undoubtedly, it was not just Matthias, not just Joseph, who were considered to be gifted, but each person had gifts to offer to keep the Jesus movement going. Today, our house of faith is multiplied by an intimacy of knowing the gifts of God's people in our church, and encouraging the use of those gifts for the purpose of God. Not every person will serve on a lay leadership committee. Not every person will be in a place of clergy leadership. But every person has a role to play in the mission of God in the world. And I believe the house church experience that we're having in this moment is helping each of us to realize that you are needed. You are a vital component to the church of Jesus Christ in the world. Whether a church is 25 people or 5,000 people, not one of those people is meant to be inconsequential. Not one is meant to be laid aside as useless to the mission of God and the multiplication of his church in the world. In the early church, as we read, people came and gathered in homes with those who they knew were followers of Jesus, especially those who were interested in learning more about Jesus. They gathered for the meals, for the prayers, for the acts of Christian service. And they began to practice what it meant to be a disciple. And as they gathered in homes week after week and joined in ministry with these other disciples, they began to feel the call of Christ on their life. And they were moved in such a way that they repented of their sin, declared Christ as Lord and Savior, and were baptized and initiated into God's church and God's family. As I think about the 120 who helped the Jesus movement flourish and grow in exponential ways. I think about the church today, specifically in these unprecedented moments. I think about the many folks who have gifts, who have always been behind the scenes. But in this moment, they are being placed in the spotlight because of the gifts and the talents that God has given them. I'm so proud to see many of the folks in our church who are sewers and knitters and quilters putting their talents to tangible use in the world as they churn out hospital masks as quickly as they can make them to be given to medical workers, to the elderly, and now to anyone else who needs them. For too long, that ministry has been in the shadows, but now it comes to the forefront because it is mission critical for the church and for the world in this moment. They have and will always have a place in the church, but it is in this moment where I am so proud that they are on full display. I'm so grateful to be a pastor of a church who on Friday distributed food through our mobile food pantry to 100 families in need. To know that as each person came through and received their food, that we were living into the teaching of Christ. As he tells us that when you feed the hungry, you are feeding him. To know that each of those volunteers, as we practiced the safety protocols, came together knowing that they were like the 120, that they had a specific place in God's church and that they have a role to play in bearing witness to the power of Christ being alive in the world through the distributing of food and through the sharing of dignity to another. It is this intimacy of community that allows us to call on people like those making masks, to call on those who are distributing the food, to know that they have the gifts and the graces for a time such as this, and that the Lord is calling them to share those in a way that transcends what they ever thought they would be doing with those gifts. Because as they are called upon, we see within them a joy, a conviction, a drive that comes from when someone discovers their purpose that God has given them. Whether it is making masks or distributing food or calling people who are alone or working extra shifts so that others can have the goods or services that they need. It has been amazing to see the people of God knowing their place, claiming their place, and living into their place, even as we are apart, even and especially as we are worshiping in our homes. It seems as if every 500 years, the capital C church experiences some kind of transition, some kind of major shakeup in the way we think about our faith, and the way in which we connect to our faith and to the church of which we are a part of, and for which generations to come will be a part of. Of course, it's hard to know in the present whether or not or how we are a part of a great awakening or a part of a movement that will change the world as we know it. But I am convinced, rather I am convicted, in believing that this pandemic is reigniting faith in the church of Jesus Christ. Because people are in their homes choosing to worship God as a family, choosing to take that time, choosing to claim the gift of community, choosing to claim the victory that Jesus has over sin and death, choosing to be a part of the family of God, of the house of faith drawn together by the Holy Spirit. The world as we know it will not be the same after all of this is said and done, and the church of Jesus Christ will be changed for the better after this. Because the people of God are rising to the occasion. The people of God are showing their friends and their families and their neighbors and the world what the church has and is and will always be about. And that is meeting the needs of the least, the last, and the lost, especially in times of greatest trial and tribulation. People in the church and outside of the church are rediscovering our need for faith, the need to belong. the need for community. As you are in your own home, you are being reminded of this house of faith in Acts 1 and the house of faith that you live in each and every day. And a house of faith, I believe, means just that. That every man, woman, and child has a role to play in that home. And in God's house of faith, it is even more so. No, God's not out assigning chores, but you have been blessed and commissioned as an ambassador of the living God. As we are worshiping in our homes, just as faithful Christians have for centuries before us, as we worship the risen Christ, trust in his provision, and serve through offering our lives, our talents, our gifts, as you are in your home, claim your home as a house of faith. Claim Perdido Bay as your house of faith, where you are at home, where you are important, you are noticed, you are loved. Whether you are worshiping right now with family, or whether you are at home isolated from others, hear this. You are not alone. You are not isolated. You are inextricably bound together with all of those in Perdido Bay United Methodist Church, all of your brothers and sisters around the globe, through the power of the Holy Spirit. Because as you worship in your home, you are not just worshiping in your home, but you are worshiping with the saints in heaven and earth, declaring the praises of Almighty God, joining in his worship and his praise that knows no end. And the house of faith, you are always with others, and you are always bound together by the Spirit to share in God's power now and for all time. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. As we respond to God's word, we have the opportunity to respond by giving of God's tithe and our offerings. We have many ways you can give during this time. You can give by sending a check here to the church, and you can find the information on the screen of our mailing address. You can give on our website, perditobay.church/giving. We thank you for your generosity. We thank you for your commitment to the mission and ministry of Jesus Christ in and through Perdido Bay United Methodist Church in these unprecedented times and in the months to come as we continue to be the heart of the community. God, receive these gifts. Bless them and use them for the declaring of your greatness in this world and the meeting of the needs of our neighbors and our community. We ask all of this in Christ's holy name. Amen. As we close our service today, I thank you once again for joining us, for worshiping in your home and sensing the presence of God and knowing the presence of God in your home. But as we depart from this time of worship, may we receive this blessing. May God's grace and peace and power and presence be upon you, be upon your families, be upon your neighbors, be upon this world. May God bring healing. May God bring hope. May God be redemption, bring redemption. And may God continue to bring his peace upon you and upon this world, which knows no end. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace.